just airplanes and pilots. There's also a beekeeper. So let's go.
Bye. Bye, Tessa.
Ready?
That's it.
Okay, see you.
Oh my goodness.
This is the first.
Here are all of the bees. They're crawling all around. This is the beekeeper getting the honey.
He's gonna explain, right?
Now, yeah. This is what a frame of honey looks like before I take it out of the hive, okay? You see, right here, honey that's ripe is capped, okay? That's capped honey. What I do is I then take this frame and I use a very, very hot knife. This hot knife, I go down and I cut the cappings off, okay? And what that does is that exposes the liquid honey that's in those cells.
Sweet,
sweet, sweet stuff in there. Yep.
Wow, that's delicious already. Look at that.
Yeah, you're already drooling.
Oh, I am already.
I got you.
I'm drooling here.
Okay.
Oh, okay. You want to taste it? Tessa, do you want? Diago, do you want?
Can I have a piece, please?
What's that?
Can I have a piece, please?
Eat it.
Yes, I'll get you a piece. Give me just a moment.
Okay.
You eat it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you can eat it. Eat it.
Absolutely.
That's
the idea.
That's the
idea. I gave it to you.
Mmm, how does it feel?
It's a bit hot. Mm-hmm. You see, here's my ring for you.
The beekeeper is spinning the wheel. I'm gonna get some honey. Right now I'm waiting in line. I'm filling up the jar.
How is it?
It's sweet.
Sweet?
We've already got.
You got?
Yes. Yep, thank you. Yep.
Oh, that's bad.
Because I can always spin more honey out. It's not a problem.
Thank you.
Okay.
Now the bees came to the airport. So we are right here right now.
Oh, okay.
And the bees are up here at the end of the runway.
Oh.
Yeah. They had to be away enough from public spaces.
Away from the people. Okay.
Yeah.
And there he is.
In
what's his name?
That's Chris.
That's Chris. The beekeeper right there who just show us, right, Tessa? Like the honey frames, the extractor.
Yep.
Very nice. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
And your name is?
Bernadette.
My brother's gonna read me the story, Queen Bee Finds a Home, from the bees from East Hansom.
Queen Bee finds a home.
House?
Mm-hmm. Where's the lighthouse? Here where we live. You remember? We went there in the summer. You remember the town? Montauk. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they're using the illustrations with places where we live here in Long Island.
Here's the blue jay.
Blue jay, mm-hmm.
But they call it blue bird.
Beehives. Airplanes and the beehives. Yeah, right there.
I didn't see any. I'm gonna count all of the jars of honey that we got from the honey festival. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I guess 6. 3 plus 3 equals 6. Huh. 6, 7, 8, 9.
Wow, right? That was so much fun.
Yeah. My brother says anybody can be a beekeeper even if it's just for Halloween.
Well, good evening and welcome to the fifth part of our Taking Flight with the Beginning Beekeeping class. I hope you enjoyed that short little video clip. We had such a ball at the honey harvest party here in at the East Hampton Airport. And I hope this year you take part in the teaching bee yard that we have there at the airport, to take part in a once a month inspection and what's going on in the bee yard. If I could get the next slide, please. We can get past that. You guys all know me by now. Okay, this is just, I just wanted to bring a reminder up to you guys. May 7th is when we are going to install a whole bunch of bees right here at the airport. The start time is going to be at 12 o'clock. I expect it'll take us anywhere from 1 to 2 hours to do. A couple things, please bring your own smoker and your bee gear. I intend for this to be a practice run for you for when your own bees are here and you're able to put them in. What we are going to be announcing, Bernadette and I will be, we've worked on a monthly date that you'll be able to come to the bee yard. It will require that you sign up, because we actually have a limited number of people can actually gain access to the bee yard. Thank you. The next one. Okay, this is what the hands-on classes typically look like. You see, we've got a whole bunch of people. You will be paired with somebody at a hands-on class so that you take the record keeping of that beehive, and then we talk about what goes on or what you saw in that beehive. Could I have the next one, please? I have to tell you, spring is here, right? Everybody felt today at 45 degrees, and it felt like one of those warm 45 degrees. You take a look at all the bees that are flying right there. That's your first indicator. If I could have the next one. But I wanted to put this, if you take a close look at the back legs of this bee, you can actually see pollen. And pollen is one of those wonderful things for a beekeeper to see, because it is an indicator that the queen is still alive. You don't know it just yet, but she is, because part of the idea is that you see pollen. Pollen is the protein side of the bee's diet. And in that, when they are rearing brood, like eggs and larvae in the pupae, they require pollen and honey. So when you see fresh pollen coming in, you tend to get very happy as a beekeeper. If I could have the next one. Okay, here's just a little housekeeping. I'm going to be posting on Facebook and in Agway and Riverhead the exact date and arrival of your nukes. I only have the exact date about a week before they actually arrive. I am going to put out group email notifications, and let me put it to you like this. I'm also enlisting your help, because I've been proven to have a defective memory, okay? And that means I don't necessarily get everybody in the email list. If you know somebody that says, hey, I bought bees from Chris, when are yours coming? And you can fill them in, all right? It really will help me. The meeting spot will be here at, actually, I made a mistake here. The meeting spot is not going to be at Halleckville. I'm sorry about that. The meeting spot for the bees is actually going to be at Fink's Farm in Calverton, okay? But make sure you have your location and your equipment ready. If I could have the next one. Okay? Your location of your bees should already have been selected. Many of you that have been taking this course actually have sent me your site selections, so we know where you're going to put them. What do you have to have ready? You need to have your foundation, your platform that you're going to put your bees on should already be built at this stage of the game. All right? That should be there. your equipment, some of you are buying equipment from me, so it's all been, that should already be selected, and you're going to put it together before your bees arrive. Those of you who would like to take part on March 12th, from 12 to 2 a.m., that's how Halleckville got in there, I am doing an equipment building party / demonstration at Halleckville on March 12th from 12 to 2 o'clock. This way you learn how to put your equipment together well before your bees arrive. The second part is, or the last part is, your simple syrup that you're going to prepare for your bees. Please don't make it any more than a week in advance, okay? The syrup itself, if you make it more than a week in advance, it's going to go bad on you. The next one, please. On it. When your bees arrive, we talked about this. You're going to install those bees into a full-size box, just like what I have in front of me. But make sure you light your smoker and put your bee gear on, okay? You're going to remove the screws from the lid of the nukes, and then you're going to transfer the bees, just like we saw on the video of where I took the swarm and I transferred the frames right into the hives. And again, you just shake and knock out. I know this is review, but I wanted to get this out here because we did cover a lot. Then you just lay the box on its side in front, and I promise you, most of those bees are going to leave fairly quickly. The next one, please. Once you've got yourself set up, you're going to add your feeder on top, fill it with syrup, close it up, and get your cup of coffee and say, I survived my first installation. The next one, please. Okay, record keeping. This is what I want to say. In the beginning, you know, in the beginning, yeah. Well, this is the beginning. Starts with your date of hive installation. And what I want you to really do is on the day that you install them, just record your weather that day. What was it like? Was it sunny? What was the temperature, the wind, what have you? Because what you're going to see in the next day or two, I want you to first recording when did you first sight pollen coming into the hive? Second is note what the color of that pollen is. And then note the direction of the flight. Why do I put all of this together? Because when you go back into your Google Earth and you put a pin and you locate where your beehive is, direction is going to tell you where they're going. Color is actually, there's a great pollen color association with flowers in bloom at this time of year. And you can actually make an association. Part of it is I want to start to give you, from the outset of your record keeping, a chronological order of what's coming in bloom, where your bees are going, and you're going to put it together, and it's going to be a marvelous matrix for you. Could I have the next one, please? In the hive inspections, I want to emphasize this. These are the big three. Are your queen right? And when we talk about queen right, that means in the frame, do you see eggs, queen-sided, food stores. You as a beginner, we're going to go through this a little bit because the presence and the kind of the quantity that you see are going to be hard for you as a beginner to kind of quantify. But the pest, namely Varroa, we've spoken about this. This is one where I hope you do come to the teaching yard. We're going to do a demonstration early. It will be early summer, be between the May and June inspection, where we'll do a demonstration of how you monitor, what it looks like to treat and for your bees. And I've actually added a third portion to it. I actually do a post-treatment mite drop check on my bees on it. Could I have the next one, please? Okay, what's really important here is, what is the frequency? Because a lot of this is you say to yourself, how much time am I spending in here? First off, most beginners spend way too much time in their beehives too often. Here's kind of what really works for me. When your bees arrive from May to June, you're going to be in them once a week. My suggestion is that you set a day that you want to go in there. P.S. Nobody dies if you go to 8 days, 9 days, or you come in shorter at 6 days. I don't want you to be in there every third day, okay? Keep it at about once a week. In July and August, as the heat comes on, guess what? You can stretch it out a little bit further to once every 10 days pretty easily. September, we come back down into that every 7 days, and we're gonna look at this a little bit. And then October, what ends up happening, that's the last month I want to see you within a beehive, where you're prying apart every frame or doing things like that. November to February, all you're doing is top checking where your bees are at. If I could have the next one, please. Okay, so I love to come to this because in a hive inspection, your hive, you want to stay to 7 minutes or less to minimize the amount of disruption. So I know you all have phones. And on that phone, what you're going to do from the first time you inspect, you're going to say to yourself, I'm setting my timer for 7 minutes. It is not, let me tell you this, it's not meant to penalize you. And what I really want you to get is the early part of the season is when your bees are the friendliest. The latter part of the season, the bees are not as friendly. If you get into the discipline of 7 minutes, you're going to be able to navigate the second part of the season much better than the first part, okay? The other thing about it with your nuke, when you've been feeding, a lot of people say, well, how long should I feed? About a month. That's about where I want. I do want you to stop after that, and there's a rationale. About a month after your bees are here, the onset of the main honey flow is going to be in about 2 weeks' time. I don't want you, if your hive is really pushing and building, you really don't want to compromise the honey with sugar. So just before we go into the next slide, I actually want to review exactly what I'm talking about by actually demonstrating it. Here I come into my beehive here, and I got 7 minutes, right? So when I get my smoker lit, and I get my handy dandy hive tool, okay? Once I get going here, what I'm going to do to enter to the hive is I will actually smoke by pushing the bellows quite hard, and I do no more than 3 puffs. So I break it into a third. 1, 2, 3, right? Then what I like to do in terms of that is I like to put the smoker between my legs and I can kind of crush it. And then I can kind of waddle and waddle around on it, okay? So now that's my starting point on it. When I take this lid off, I use the pry side of the hive tool always to pry things apart. And when I pry it apart, I take this up and I gently put a puff, maybe a second puff of smoke, and you probably do a second because you're nervous, all right? What I like to do then is I turn that outer cover upside down, okay, behind the hive. And the reason I do that is I want to make sure that I have, in case I get in trouble here, I have a free access to get away from the hive. I'm not expecting you to have that issue, okay? So then when you pry this apart, you just do a slight puff across the top bars. And then again, this comes, and I like to change everything 90 degrees as I stack up. So in the case of, in this kind of case, this is actually what your hive is going to look like when it's full size, okay? You're not going to have this many boxes, all right? But what I want to come to, and we'll come back to this, is once I've got down to say where the hive is, how many frames do I really need to inspect, okay? I think that becomes a real question. And we have our big three are queen, right? Food stores and pests, right? So what I like to do is then you come, you smoke gently, and I use now the curved section of the hive tool to pry apart, to separate, because oftentimes the frames will have propolis and wax. What I like to do is I then take the outermost frame out. And the outermost frame, once you've taken it out, you actually just take a very cursory look, because usually the outer frames do not have much in the way of bees, brood, honey, or any kind of action. Don't waste up 4 minutes of your 7 minute time on your outer frame, okay? So what I like to do, I just do a quick check, right? And then I place it on its ear in the back. Now I get to the meat and potatoes, okay? And what I like to do is I then take the next three frames and I take that hive tool and I crack it apart. And if you take a look, what I've got is I've got almost an inch of room between me and the frame I now want to take out. In that frame, I crack it again, use the straight part to pick it up, and then I lift this out straight. It will be on that frame, in that center frame, that you are going to then be able to look into the cells, into the cells of this frame, and be able to determine, do I have eggs? And if you have eggs, you now checked off number one of your list. Number two, do I have nutrients? Now this is where it gets kind of tricky, and I'm going to give you a couple of tricks to the trade. First is, feel how heavy the frame is. And just trust yourself there. This is not going to be precise science, but what I want you to trust, if it's light, probably not a lot of food stores on it. If it feels heavy to you, then you can start to say, hey, maybe I got weight. So when I look for weight, what does that look like? What you're going to see, and where I would focus my attention in terms of food stores, is on the upper portion of the frame. And in that upper portion, do I see a liquid? If it looks like a liquid, that's your nectar and honey. If it looks real chalky and real quite colorful, that's pollen. So now you're able to actually, on that one frame, one side, you're actually able to all of a sudden say, I see brood, I saw eggs, and I saw some honey and pollen. Quantifying that, the way I do like to do this is, I've now got this, let's just say that was a light frame, okay? I expect that to be light in May when I've just put my nuke into the hive. Why? It's just starting. So I don't get myself frazzled with that. What I like to check is, where's that margin? In other words, I was in frame number two and I was in the center. So once I got into the center, I saw, wow, I've got brood, I've got some food going on. And then I like to switch over two more frames. So now I've come to the other side of my hive and I pull that frame out. And this frame is going to tell me a story. If this frame there tells me the story that, guess what, I've got all honey in here, now I'm able to say they've done a significant amount of storage than they did when I put them in a week ago. And that, it becomes a baseline for you. And this might be a little bit heavier, and you say it had moderate weight. What does that look like to you as a beekeeper? That looks like that you have a hive that is starting to grow. And you also understand that because you're in the early part of the spring season, you understand that you are in your growth portion of your beehive's life cycle. Could I have the next slide, please? Okay. This is one question everybody asks me about. When I have started with just my nuke, this is the only box that you were started with, okay? And if you're in a 10 frame, that nuke is going to take up half this box, all right? I've got my fingers on one side and I've got the hive tool on the other side. That's the starting point that your nuke is at. The 70% rule says they filled two more frames. They are going to do that very quickly for you, okay? And quickly, I mean, they may not be in the first inspection, but I can promise you by about the second inspection, they will be there. It is probably the most common thing I've seen with beekeepers is that they don't add that second box quick enough. And then I got the 1-800 call Chris, and what happens is their bees swarm. And part of that is because they get crowded in that box and they say, boom, I'm gone. So what I would be ready for is in that second inspection to have that second box ready, whether it's a deep or a medium, I don't mind. So let's say you did your second inspection, you add your second box right on, okay? There's nothing you have to do. You don't have to change frames. You don't have to move anybody just yet. Could I have the next slide, please? Okay, again, I really stress this. You wanna stay to 7 minutes, all right, on it. You'll find out soon enough why I do that. During June, I put this in here for a reason, is frame rotation. Most of you are going to be starting with frames of what we call foundation. The frame is the wood perimeter. The foundation is that beeswax, okay? So what oftentimes happens, now you put 10 frames of foundation in this hive. And what often happens is the hive may go up in the center, might go up on one side on it. So you, the beekeeper, are gonna be watching where that activity is. How do I check it? Quick check is you look down between the frames and just look if you see bees. And you will see them. It's very apparent. You'll see layers of bees. That's going to tell you a bulk of where the bees are. And if they come in on this one side, you, the beekeeper, might know that, okay, I now need to rotate. And it's exactly as it sounds. Where the bees are, they will have drawn out. They will have made comb. Where they're not, they won't have touched. So you, the beekeeper, get to play a little bit of rotation. So if this was, let's just say, on the edge of the hive, I move that almost dead center and put the other frame out towards the edge for now. And that way, what you end up doing is you get all your frames, what we call drawn out or made comb, and what that is, this becomes a starting point. When all 10 or all 8 of them within a box are full, then you know that you've got a hive now that can fill this entire box with the brood, the honey, the pollen that it needs. If I could have the next one, please. During July, what happens is our honey flow comes to an end. It's kind of a cruel thing. I mean, we just started in May, and then by July 4th, most of the honey flow is done. And the quantity of the honey and the amount of brood, bees, and pollen, now this becomes, you actually almost have to start paying attention as a beekeeper. Because what you want to do is you're actually thinking, believe it or not, in July, you're starting to get your bees ready for winter. If I could have the next one, please. Okay? This is what I like to use as a kind of a summary. During July, both of these boxes right here should already have 70 to 80% filled with bees. You'll see it. It will look, be apparent. 7 frames of brood or more. How am I going to know that? Remember, we talked about we're going to be at one margin. So that's frame one. I can guarantee you there'll be frames of brood going through. When you get to the center, do you still see? So you can literally count as you go along on it. What I like to see is a total of 7 frames of brood or more. What that means is in this box and in this box, if I've got 7 frames of brood, I'm doing pretty darn good at this point in time. The other thing that I want to see is I want to see, remember we talked about when you put that hive on, you just started to see honey. it will be even more apparent during July that you're going to be able to see a full frame of honey. In this case, I want to see a total of about 4 frames of honey between the top and the bottom. Just one word, I can't do fractions, okay? So when I find honey, let's just say, in this frame, and it's only on one side, I call that a frame. I don't call it a half a frame, because I'll never be able to keep track of it, all of that on it. And then I think probably one of the more difficult things is, as you as a beginner, is to understand that band of pollen. And that's one thing I really try to get you to look on hands-on, because once you learn where that pollen looks, what the pollen looks like and where it's placed, it becomes an invaluable tool to you. The other part about it is pollen's actually very light in weight. It's not a weighty substance, but it's absolutely essential. If I could have the next one, please. In early August, what happens, I want to move through this because your bees are still filling all of this out. 5 or more frames of brood is good. Notice how it actually went down a little bit. Honey now should be taking over much more of this, all right? And pollen taking up at least 1 full frame. Again, that will be apparent because as you look through your frames, you should be seeing bands that are at least 1 inch or 1.5 inches thick. If you're not seeing that, you actually want to pay attention to it. If I could have the next slide, please. In late August, that's probably going to be the first time you as the beekeeper actually noticed that the population has actually dwindled and declined. It's actually probably, in my book, one of the more tricky parts of managing bees here on Long Island. Because what happens is we know the population is in the decline. What we don't necessarily understand is how steep is that decline. In other words, is their food source not adequate? And where we determine that is by our pollen bands, okay? That's why I'm focused on that pollen band, not as much on the honey just yet. Because when the pollen band goes from being that 1 inch width to being the thickness of my finger, it tells me there's a shortage of the protein in the hive. What that does, the knock-on effect, if you will, is the queen cuts back on laying eggs. That then shows up several weeks later as a great decline in the population on that one. All right, could I have the next one, please? Okay, so the Varroa treatment plan. This is what I like to do, is that monitor and treat. It's once a month from June to October. This is a baseline threshold, 2 mites per 100. It really isn't a lot, okay? What to use and what to treat with, we're going to do that in the hands-on class. I'm not going to be able to cover that here in a lecture series. But what I would say to you is please visit the Cornell website for the Cornell Recommends and get yourself familiar with the Honeybee Health Coalition website. Great, great videos and demonstrations that will get you up to speed so when you come live load, we can go ahead and do it. If I could have the next one, please. Okay. So feeding your bees, 3 to 4 weeks at the start, simple syrup. I love to use this thing called Honey Bee Healthy. It's a supplement. I want to be very clear. The science says that there's no benefit to using it. I love the smell of it. It's a spearmint essential oil. I love the smell of it. In my book, it's cheap and easy. It's 1 teaspoon per gallon. You're not going to rock the boat. But I find I think I see benefits. The next one, please. Okay. Feeding your bees. The summertime, basically what you really want to see it is what are my nutrition levels? This is the thing. In the summertime, if you've got low brood, that means those before those lower than those parameters, low honey stores, you're going to need to feed them. All right. I think 9 times out of 10, though, you're going to see your bees are well within their parameters, and you're probably not going to be feeding them in the summertime. Let me rephrase that: in the early summertime, from June to July. August becomes money time. That's where you're going to have to check and see whether or not your food stores are going up. Something I've started to taking, going back to old school time, is I start bringing out a bath scale out to the bee yard with me. And the reason I do that is I can then take this box and put myself on the scale and weigh it, right? And then I can just take it back off, and I'll know the kind of the gross weight of that. And I'll put a mark either on the side of the box or on the top of my cover. And what I find with that is I'll do that on, let's just say, week one of the month. And then the third week, I'll do it again. And what it gives me is a waypoint to say, well, I thought I had 42 last time, and then I get on it, and it says you got 36. What that tells you is that your hive is using more food than it's taking in. That's an indicator to say it is time to feed them, all right? I find that to be really useful, really simple. The other part about this is that you can put that feed on in the summer, and you might find the bees don't use it. Don't take that as a personal rejection. It's not. What it is the bees are telling you they're just fine with where they are. They will, when they start feeding, you're gonna know it. This fall, we started feeding some of my bees back in Riverhead, and I had put it on, and for 3 weeks, they barely looked at the top feeder. Well, then all of a sudden, it was like somebody took out the suction cup pipe, and they literally drank a gallon of feed in about 2 days. So it will tell you all of a sudden when they get there. If I could have the next one, please. Right. So I will come back to this. Initially, the bees aren't going to use your feed, and they probably won't even touch your pollen supplement. But you will notice that change. I think the take-home point with this particular one is record when that happens. Because you, as a beekeeper, when you get into next year, you're going to be able to look at it and say, oh, wow, that's right. Right around here it happened. And if you follow your growing degree days, if you're going hotter than normal, you're going to see that feed need come earlier. If it's cooler than normal, it'll probably come later. If I could have the next one, please. Okay. I know I've got to emphasize this. With Varroa, please monitor once a month. And if you've got any questions with regard to treatment, my phone number is available, my email is available. I'm happy to help you out on what might be a material to use for treatment. The other thing is a small hive beetle. Small hive beetles, they've got these traps that you can place in the hive. Where you place them is usually just between the outermost frame and the second frame. And I put one on one end of the hive, and I put the second one over here. I'm going to actually change this recommendation here. I put it out that you can do that in July or what have you. I have no trouble putting it in with the hives when you install them. It's $3 a hive to put those two traps in. And here's the deal. The oil doesn't go bad in them, and they're a great indicator if you have anything. But 9 times out of 10, you're not going to see them early in the season. You might see them later in the season. Could I have the next slide? Okay. So fall and winter preparations, okay? Here's what ends up happening is that big entrance down in the bottom, you're going to reduce. And you're going to have any kind of a wood stick. You might get one that's pre-cut with your hive. You put that in starting in the September. one thing that I want to touch upon is I brought in here today something called a queen excluder. This queen excluder will normally go on right around or before Labor Day weekend. What I like to start with it is up above the second deep, okay? Because the reason for that is these two boxes are the hive cavity that you're going to be overwintering your bees in. I like to get it on right there in that early September or late August, early September, because what it does is these wire strands, first off, they don't allow the queen to move up into your honey supers anymore. Second part is they do act as a restrictor for the bees, even the worker bees themselves, to go through. What happens is think of the excluder as being like a door that the bees have to go open and close to go through. Bees are kind of like you and I, they're a little bit lazy, and they'll fill below that excluder first before they'll go through the excluder. So what that does is that makes your frames that you're in your second box, they will start to fill that with honey, which is very good, because what happens is as they fill it, they are pushing the brood chamber where the queen is laying down lower and lower. That's of paramount importance, because in the bee overwintering, when they form a cluster, their movement is always in an upward direction. So the goal is that come September, you've got your queen excluder here and you're moving her down. Come October, let's just say mid-September, you might even move the excluder all the way down to the first one to keep the queen all the way down into that first box so that all the honey stores, or let's just say 80% of the honey stores, are up above that brood chamber. And this kind of guarantees that you've positioned your bees correctly. If I could have the next one, please. Okay, I like to put this in here because here's the deal. By about Columbus Day weekend, you are really at your last chance to set your beehive up. I'm gonna trust that you've made sure that your mite loads are down. Second is that you've taken a weight of this second box. And if it is not really heavy for you, you know you've got to feed. And you have a chance now to feed them for another four or five weeks on that. It's also you as a beekeeper last chance to be able to rotate or change your frames around so that, again, you put your brood down, you've got your honey stores right up above them, and some frame. People often ask me, well, where would you put your frame of pollen? About the third frame in on either side of the super. About the third frame in. Because that comes more towards the margin in on that. If I could have the next one, please. In winter, okay, one of the most important things is please remember to take your queen excluder out by that middle of October. Okay, you leave it in. What will happen is as your bees move in an upward trajectory through the hive, they are no longer, the queen can't get through, but the cluster can. So they may make it through the winter, but they'll be queenless come spring. All right? Second thing is I like to have a hive reduced back to this level, okay, to the two deep level. Yes, you can clearly overwinter with the medium on as well, but I would not go much higher than this on it. I like to add, if you're in a high wind risk area, to add a small moving strap to actually just keep everybody together. And I like to have it so that the strap actually wraps around my stand. So I've got it all as one unit. That paid dividends for me earlier last month when we had that 70 knots of wind that came through. I have a location in Sagaponack, and a whole hive went over. It had a half a cinder block on top, and it was strapped and went over in that thing. The beauty part about it is when a hive goes over in the winter, all in one unit, it doesn't crack the seal. The hive is not exposed to water or air or the wind or the cold wind. And all it took was for me to straighten it back up, and it was good to go. When I talk about adding an upper entrance, a lot of people do not like to punch a hole in their brand new boxes because they're afraid it's going to hurt. It doesn't hurt. The placement of the upper hole is either just below this hand hole or to the side of it. Either one will work fine. The size of it is about a 1-inch hole. I find that's actually probably one of the most effective things that you can do to your beehive to keep moisture from accumulating within the hive. And the second part is you've given your bees a chance in the event that the lower entrance gets blocked by dead bees or snow or something, that they've got a place to go out of it, on it. And then I say put a winter inner cover. And what does that look like? Well, a winter inner cover simply looks like this, except it's got a thicker rim. You can actually make an inch or an inch and a half shim that goes right around. When you put it down in on here, then I take 4 pounds of sugar, which is exactly what one bag is, and you can pour it right around there. And what that acts as is a moisture wick, and it actually acts as an emergency dry feed. If I could have the next one. In wintertime, this is one that what I want to emphasize is, because now that you've been a beekeeper all season, you're worried about them, okay? You're going to worry about them. I know that. I worry about my bees, okay? And I do this all the time, all right? Only open your hive in the warmest part of the day. And what you're doing is you're going to take the outer cover off, and then to check where your cluster is. This is why I brought this tonight, because I wanted you to see. You take your inner cover off. I do not break any boxes open, but I take a little pen flashlight and I put it down so that I can actually look and see where the cluster is. And oftentimes, in the early part of winter, you could put your whole hive tool down and still not reach the cluster, because it should be down quite low. It should be very far. The reason I have you do that kind of check, and this kind of check, I wouldn't start with doing it much before after the 1st of January. But once you start, I would do it every 2 weeks, because this will give you a bead. If in February 1st, your bees are up right around this top bar in that time, they're telling you they're going to get hungry very quickly. Means they're running out of food as they're coming up. And in that case, you know, with your little inner cover that you had 4 pounds on, guess what? You add some more sugar in on there, on it. If I could have the next one. And the final part is, when you're into winter, you start planning for next year, what you learned from this year. But one thing I want to just come back to is, don't break apart the boxes. Because when you break apart the boxes in winter, you break the cluster. Remember, bees are cold-blooded. They will not recover like you and I. It's not like they can get chilled and then warm back up. That is why I say to you do your work now during the warmer part, so that in the winter part, let the bees do their work. And with that, I'll take whatever questions you got.
Okay, so you know that I'm not getting nukes.
Right.
So I'm going to be behind everybody else by a month.
Yep.
So I should start feeding mine right away, obviously. Should I put a pollen patty in?
No. No pollen patties early spring. That's going to, any time pollen patties come is after mid-July, okay?
So no matter, because I don't have anything
going.
Whether it's package or nuke, it makes no difference in that
parameter.
But I want to caution in terms of pollen patties, even in the summertime, never put the full pollen patty on. Use only a third of the size that comes out. And here's the rationale. Many of these, it's a weird thing, these pollen patties tend to attract small hive beetle. And if you use a full patty like that, what ends up happening is the small hive beetle lays eggs underneath it, and you'll find a whole lot. So if you do a third, the bees can actually eat it quicker than the hive beetle will be able to lay eggs, okay?
Now you said sometimes the bees don't eat the syrup for a couple of weeks. Is that okay then? Do I need to change the syrup out in between, or?
Most of the time the answer to that is no, but use your eyes, because sometimes they may get a mold, any kind of mold or anything, it's garbage time.
So just a visual check?
Yes, it is a visual check. It's very clear, yeah. Yes, have we got any questions?
One second. Yeah, we do.
Yeah, we do. Give me a sec. And I mean, I got a personal question, though. It's very personal. All right. So what I'm wondering is, okay, so there's two questions that I have. One is, do you know anyone that installs like either a Nest video camera or something like that into the hive so they can review it remotely? I remember I talked to a few beekeepers a while ago who used to use a infrared, like a portable FLIR, to look at the hive temperatures during the winter to make sure that they were still alive. But then I was just wondering, like, okay, so if somebody wanted to limit the amount of contact that they had inside the hive, do you know anyone that uses like a video camera in there? Because that way it would take care of two birds with one stone, kind of.
All right, you sound worse than, you know, that mother hen that's just looking on things. But here's the truth of it.
It's my generation.
Jason, I actually have a thermal imaging camera, okay? But I do run a lot more hives than most of the beginners here are. And the thermal imaging camera starts at about $350, even if you put it to your phone. Does it work? Yes, I love it. I actually use it more in the summertime when I'm called in for hive removals out of buildings, because it gives me a good signature where the hive is. It absolutely does work. It's a good tool if you want that. But I was just trying to show you cheap and easy to be able to check your bees, especially if you have two hives. With regard to the terms of doing camera probes within the hive in the winter, you know, you can certainly use that snake that they have that hooks up right to your iPhone. But I don't think that you gain anything from that in the wintertime. There is a really neat app, I think it's called BeeMinder, which actually monitors the hive movement during the course of the year. But I'm not real familiar with the software on that one.
All right, that's cool. And then the other one that I had was, so when we get into the idea of like kind of like ecosystems, right? So your bees are going to be healthier if they have a lot to feed off of in the area, right? So for instance, is it a good idea for a person that is like, let's just say they're a very... tentative gardener. They like gardening. They have a lot of flowers. They have a lot of wildflowers in their garden. Are there any other kind of tips like that, like to help the health of your bees?
You know what? There's never a negative to planting flowers. Okay? There's never a negative to that. But what really does help is to understand, and I think there's loads of reference material on the web and in books about what plants could you plant. Look, My wife happens to love lavender, so guess who has a whole lot of lavender in his bee, in his yard, okay? There's not a negative to it. I do actually encourage it. What I have found is if you're saying, look, I want to plant flowers that are bee-friendly, I tend to get the flowers that bloom later in the season, not earlier, because we have plenty of tree pollen and nectar sources in the spring for the bees. We tend to be weak on the flower volume, size, and shape for the bees in the fall, meaning from August onward.
Okay, and now I have some other questions that were emailed in. So let's see, Riley from Montauk. Do we need to be concerned about pesticides or fertilizer affecting the bees? What precautions should be taken?
Do we need? Absolutely. My bee operation is actually inspected twice a year by the USDA, and part of that inspection revolves around trying to take some pollen samples from in the frames within the hives to check for pesticide residue. Last year, I had two different pesticides that showed up in some of my pollen in my hives, and it was directly linked to some of the fungicides that are used at some of the farms. I found the best way of kind of minimizing the exposure of your hive to pesticides is keep them out of the direct drift of a farm, especially if you're next door to a farm. Keep them out of the direct drift, because most of the time the pesticides are really quite a limited active ingredient time. And if you keep the bees out of that kind of direct contact, you're probably doing about 90% of the job for them.
Okay, the next question is from Mason in East Quogue. Is honey considered organic? This kind of goes piggybacks of what you're talking before.
who asked this question, Jason?
That's Mason from East Quogue.
Yeah, that's actually a great question, because it's quite interesting. The USDA does not allow you to label your honey organic, because you cannot determine whether or not your bees fed solely on flowers that were organically grown. That being said, I think that anybody that tastes their honey from their beehive would be hard-pressed not to say that that was not organic. So it's what I call a muddy area, because in my book, if you are intentional in keeping your hive free from pesticides and any kind of not natural product in there, I think you as the beekeeper are doing your part. And I can guarantee you the bees are doing their part in terms of gathering honey.
All right.
I hope that answers his question.
I hope so too, because it was a damn good answer. So is the next one is from Cheryl in East Hampton. Is it true that male bees die after mating? If so, why do they die?
If so, what?
Well, why do they die after they mate, if they do die after mating?
You know, I'd tell her to look it up on the videotape, but here's the short answer. Yes, the drones die after they mate, because in the mating ritual of the queen and the drone, it's an outside mating up in the air, somewhere 30, 40 feet up in the air. When they are in intercourse, what ends up happening is the queen pulls away, and guess what she does when she pulls away? She pulls the innards of the drone apart, and that's why he dies after one shot.
Okay, so way to go out on a bang. And then let me get something else. So Billy from East Hampton, East Islip, asks, what type of honeybees are native to Long Island?
There are no native honeybees. Honeybees are not native to North America. So the the better question would be is it comes to now, can you get local genetic stock? And yes, that we can. That's something that I've been breeding for a number of years. But as per, you can never call honeybees native because they weren't.
All right. Well, that's our last question from, from email. So I think we're pretty good.
Cool. Well, thank you all very much. And then our last class is going to be on March 24th. It's our last class, but hopefully we'll see you all then. Thank you.